Thank you for attending. I'm Don McNeil. I organize the speakers program for the Canadian Aviation Historical Society, which meets here at the Aviation Museum on the last Thursday of every month from September through May. And our meetings are open to the public, so if you wish to attend any meetings, please do so. So it's my pleasure today to introduce our speaker, Peter Usher. Peter is a geographer, was born in Montreal. During his career, he worked with the federal government and later as a private consultant. He studied and wrote about and advised on issues relating to resource development, environmental impact, indigenous land claims across the north from Labrador to Alaska. And inspired by his cousin Joey Jacobson's letters and diaries, he turned his interest to the experience of Canadians in Bomber Command during the Second World War. Peter is the author of Joey Jacobson's War, A Jewish Canadian Airman in the Second World War. The book was published in 2018 by Wilfrid Laurier Press, and Peter lives near Ottawa in Clayton, Ontario. He spends his winters in England, where he did much of the research for the book. So Peter, welcome.
Thanks, Don. Well, thank you all for coming. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm going to talk about my, based on my book, with particular emphasis on the Hampden aircraft, which is what Joey was an air observer on, and show you some aspects of, or focus on some aspects of that aircraft. Four black horse-drawn carriages led the funeral cortege to the cemetery under leaden skies and light snow. Each bore the coffin of an unidentified flyer recovered from the wreckage of a Royal Air Force bomber. Several hundred Dutch townspeople and a platoon of German soldiers followed. The pastor who conducted the funeral service at the Lichtenvoorde General Cemetery declared that the four unknown men had fallen for a cause they knew was just. His eulogy would soon be rewarded by a term in concentration camp. A few men surreptitiously recorded these events on film at risk of their own arrest. In this second winter of the occupation, the airplane that had dropped from the sky was a harbinger of help from afar. The funeral, which the townspeople had insisted on organizing, was their first act of collective defiance. Active resistance, notably by assisting downed Allied airmen to evade capture, would follow. One of those coffins contained the body of Flight Sergeant Joseph Alfred Jacobson of Westmount, Quebec. He was the sole Canadian of the Hampden bomber crew that had crashed short of its target at Munster on the 28th of January, 1942. He had had no doubts about the justice of the cause that for which he fought. He had taken his copy of Thomas Paine's The Rights of Man on his fatal flight. Joey, as his friends and family called him, was a privileged and ambitious son, a university graduate, and an accomplished athlete. He was the only Jew on McGill University's 1938 League Championship football team, and in June 1940, he left behind a bright and secure future to enlist in the Royal Canadian Air Force. Like many new recruits, he wanted to become a pilot, but he was selected for air observer training, navigating a bomber aircraft to the target and bombing it, which seemed like office work compared to flying the aircraft, but it was office work of the most dangerous kind. Joey Jacobson was one of nearly 10,000 Canadian men killed in the service of Bomber Command in the Second World War. So what's his particular claim on our attention? Well, between July 1939 and January 1942, Joey recorded in detail what he saw and did, what was happening around him, and what he thought. He wrote about his life in Air Force training and combat, the purpose and conduct of the war, why he enlisted, and what it all meant to him. He communicated much of this to family and friends in 240 letters, and he kept some of it to himself in several diaries and notebooks. And his father, Percy, also kept a diary during the war, a record of events on the home front in Montreal, and of what he was hearing from Joe. So we know how Joe experienced and understood the execution of the war in the air, how he responded to the inevitable battle stress, and how he became both an idealist and a deadly serious warrior, because he told us, "I didn't have to speculate. I didn't have to put words in his mouth or ideas in his head. And without those letters and diaries, there would be no book." So tonight I'm going to illustrate some highlights of Joe's training and operations, with particular focus on the Handley Page Hampden bomber that he and many other Canadians flew. Now, the British Commonwealth Air Training Plan, when agreed to in December 1939, was seen by our government as our main contribution to the war effort. The doors opened in April 1940, training ramped up very quickly with the end of the phony war in May, and it became the largest national project since the transcontinental railways, consisting of over 100 schools and airfields across the country, each accommodating hundreds of students, staff, and ground crew. The plan turned out over 130,000 men, more every day than each year before the war. Joey enlisted at the end of June 1940. He entered the fifth course at the initial training school in Toronto with 550 other young men. He was selected for air observer training and was sent to number 3 Air Observer School in Regina in September, where he learned the fundamentals of air navigation, including dead reckoning and the triangle of velocities and the use of instruments for calculating these. And here he is with a bunch of his mates. And in this photo, which was a PR photo taken by the RCAF in those days, they would go around to the different airfields. In the Montreal Star shortly after, there appeared an outtake like this of Joey and a couple of photos of other guys at different stations under the caption, "Montreal's Fighting Airmen." By the way, of the 4 young men in this photo, 2 were killed and 2 were captured, I think by the end of 1942, so illustrative of the kind of casualty rate in bomber command. He then proceeded to he wrote lots. He would write letters to his friends. In this case, he's on a flying exercise over the prairies, he's writing a note to his friends. Not always the most attentive student, perhaps, but anyway. And here he is at number 2 Bombing and Gunnery School in Mossbank, which is where air observer students went on after their navigation training. And he completed his training at the Air Navigation School in Rivers, Manitoba, where he learned astral navigation. And this was a means of finding one's way over enemy territory at night when radio contact was forbidden and obviously an emergency landing was highly undesirable. It involved taking successive star shots with a bubble sextant through a canopy at the top of the aircraft, from which one's course could be plotted with the aid of star tables. Under ideal conditions, an observer could locate his position within 5 to 10 miles. The Royal Air Force had adopted the method 3 years before, but there had been no course of instruction until 1939. And Rivers was regarded as an ideal location for this because of its clear skies, and Canadian navigators were so trained with about 20 hours by graduation, and they were better qualified than their British counterparts. However, While they were learning to fly by the stars, their Luftwaffe counterparts were learning to locate themselves much more precisely with radio navigation aids, as the raid on Coventry in November 1940 very clearly illustrated. Nonetheless, about 2,000 Air Training Plan graduates, including 400 air observers, sailed for England in the spring of 1941, confident of their abilities and determined to give the enemy hell. Now, on arrival in England, the RCAF boys were sent for operational training for several weeks to learn how to handle the main force bomber aircraft. Not yet the famous Lancaster bomber, but the smaller and less effective Wellingtons, Whitleys, and in Joe's case, the Handley Page Hampden, which was dubbed the Flying Suitcase on account of its narrow fuselage. It was 3 feet wide. There, 3 feet wide. As this photo and the next one illustrate, that sort of boxy structure gave it the Flying Suitcase appellation. Many pilots liked it on account of the excellent visibility from the cockpit, its responsiveness, superior handling characteristics, even at low speeds. But it was also hazardous to fly due to an alarming and sometimes fatal tendency for uncontrollable sideslip. It didn't carry a heavy payload. 2,000 pounds of bombs was normally the maximum. But the bomb bay was well suited for carrying mines, and it was often used for mining enemy coastal waters. The Hampden had several vulnerabilities. Above all, it was poorly defended. Its machine guns fired hunting rifle caliber bullets. This is a view of one of them on the ground, so you get an idea of the profile. The turrets, here and here, were not power operated, and there was only one fixed forward gun. Even as the war began, it was no match for German fighter aircraft. It had no in-flight de-icing capabilities, and originally it did not have self-sealing fuel tanks, although that was later rectified. In Joe's estimation, the prospects for a successful bailout from the air observer's cockpit, which is there and the hatch was underneath, was poor. Hampden's had a survival dinghy on the port wing, which could be deployed in an emergency landing on water. Although the prospects for survival on a winter night in the North Sea were grim. Like all bombers, it was cold and noisy, but the Hampden was especially cramped on account of its size and configuration. The heating system and radio failures were common reasons for aborting sorties. And a long bombing raid was exhausting for the crew. Unlike the other main force bombers, the Hampden was configured for only a crew of four. So you had, this is the air observer's cockpit. The pilot is here, and at the back, those two turrets that I showed you, one for the wireless operator air gunner, and the one underneath for the air gunner. In this picture, by the way, this chap, third from left, was a classmate of Joey's. He was killed a couple weeks before Joe. Several months into the war, with respect to the Hampden, how the crew positions, other than the pilots, should be assigned was still up for discussion. And some of these ideas actually involve personnel changing places during the flight. The problem was initially resolved by dispensing with air observers, giving the second pilot some elementary navigation training, and putting him up front to do the navigation and bombing. But the first and second pilot, as you can kind of see here, were separated 8 feet apart by a narrow passageway that ran underneath the pilot's seat and down into here, so that the first pilot could hardly provide effective instruction to the second, and it was a difficult and dangerous maneuver for the second pilot to replace the first in an emergency. Arthur Harris, who was then the air officer commanding of 5 Group, regarded it as an inelegant solution. As he said, an attempt to make the best of a bad job to a problem that he asserted had been foisted upon him because Bomber Command had accepted the Hampden into service, despite its manufacturer having implored, as Harris said, almost every conceivable requirement in disregard of specifications. Operational experience during 1940 soon made it evident that there was a need for a specialist navigator in every crew. So Bomber Command dispensed with the second pilots in Hampdens, but now had to reinstate full navigational training for Hampden squadrons. This situation led to a high proportion of the Canadians who were arriving in numbers in the spring of 1941 being deployed to 5 Group Hampden squadrons, precisely because they were already trained and they had the astro-navigation skills. Joey was posted to 106 Squadron, which was one of 7 Hampden-equipped squadrons in 5 Group at the beginning of August 1941. His first assignment on the 5th of August was an operation on the Main Railway Station at Ludwigshafen. His pilot, Jerry Roberts, was on his second sortie as a first pilot, having served as a second pilot in the observer position on 7 previous operations. The 2 wireless operator air gunners had been on squadron for nearly a month. One of them, Duncan Hodgkinson, who had already begun operations in July, would fly with Joe and Jerry regularly for the next 4 months. So on this operation, ground crews were brought out the bombs and loaded up each aircraft during the afternoon, while observers were briefed on the night's objectives and weather forecasts. Right after briefing, Joe charted his aircraft's course so as to arrive over Ludwigshafen between 0115 and 0200. It was still the practice in 1941 for each aircraft to make its separate way to the target area so as to arrive within a prescribed time window long enough for it to obtain a visual fix on the target and line up on the aiming point. If crews could not identify the primary aiming point, they were supposed to find some other likely target, or as a last resort, bomb flak concentrations visible through cloud, but they were not to bring their bombs back. It was, in effect, every crew for itself. Do your best, lads. Good luck. As the shadows of evening lengthened, the 4 men emptied their pockets of anything, bus or cinema tickets, letters or photos that might disclose their flight's origin. Then they donned their flying suits, sheepskins, helmets, goggles, and parachute harnesses, gathered up their rations of coffee and chocolate, and they were driven out to the Hampden AE-193, moored at the perimeter of the grass runway. And this photo, which actually shows people exiting the aircraft, if you imagine this in reverse, pilot gets up on the wing route and goes here. The air observer, in this case, this chap with the satchel, which contains his observer instruments, he would get up second, climb in behind the pilot before takeoff, and the 2 air observers, this hatchway here, in that turret, you can see the machine guns there, would climb in through a doorway in what was called the can underneath, and that's the air gunner position. Roberts, as pilot, climbed on the port wing, then into the cockpit. Joe, carrying a sack of navigation instruments, followed him, sat behind him until airborne, and then, as I mentioned, the wireless operators and air gunners entered in through here. Jones, as the first wireless operator, went first, taking with him a wicker basket containing 2 pigeons, which he placed just forward of the upper turret it would be his responsibility in an emergency to attach the tiny canisters containing the location of the aircraft's distress written on rice paper to their legs, release the pigeons through his open turret with the birds facing forward and downward to hopefully begin their flight home. Hampden AE-193 took off well after 10 o'clock, just before sunset, as the days were still long and double summertime was in effect. Joe crawled through the narrow passageway underneath the pilot's seat to the plotting table in his office in the Perspex nose cone and spread out his maps and instruments. And here's a view of that Air Observer's cockpit. In this photo, the table is down in working position. Before reaching the target, the observer would took that table up, slide it back along this bar, and keep it up against the wall here. The bomb site is shown here, and that would actually be kept over there, and then it would be swung out when it came time to on approach to the target. The key navigation indicators, airspeed, altitude, temperature are shown on the panel there. And the drift site, which is this item here, is below it, and the bomb switches are up here to the right. The wireless operator listened to his set in silence, as any transmission, even on the ground, before takeoff could reveal the timing and direction of attack. Nonetheless, soon after becoming airborne, the aircraft was detected by German radar stations along the Dutch coast, so the crew was already in danger. Even if the aircraft no longer presented a visible silhouette against the fading twilight in the northwest. Joe checked his position as they crossed the Dutch coast at 12,000 feet. From there, he navigated by dead reckoning, periodically recording his track and altitude in his navigator's log and recalculating his course to the target on his chart. When openings in the cloud cover appeared, he tried to verify his dead reckoning by searching the moonlit but otherwise darkened landscape for visual fixes on landmarks that he could identify from his maps. He did not need to rely on astro navigation that particular night, but on other occasions when he did, well, this is another view of the instrument panels, by the way. Navigator's instruments and the bomb switches. This is a view of the canopy above, behind the pilot seat is here. So the Air Observer, if he was doing star shots, had to climb up through this passageway underneath the pilot seat. Take his position here, the canopy would be open, and he would have his bubble sextant positioned on this, and he would take star shots through the open canopy. Once deep into Germany, Joe tried to verify the direction and velocity of the wind through his drift site so that he could adjust his bomb site accordingly. A few minutes before he expected to reach Ludwigshafen, Joe stowed his divider, ruler, and protractor, folded up his table, turned off his shaded lamp to let his eyes adjust to the darkness. The target area, a distinctive junction on the Rhine, with Ludwigshafen on the left bank and Mannheim on the right, was not hard to find. But with mostly overcast skies, Joe couldn't see the railway station, so he decided to bomb the secondary target of Mannheim across the river. Kneeling over his bomb site, swung into position over the Perspex oval at the front of the aircraft, this here, Joe began lining up on his target from about 3 miles away. And in this photo here, this is one of his fellow air observers at 106 Squadron, Canadian Jim Early, DFC, who was killed in action shortly after this photo was taken, is demonstrating the use of the Mark II automatic bomb sight. And here we have an example of the automatic bomb sight, this one here on the right, was an improvement on the course setting bomb sight, which is this one here, which is what Joe had trained on in Mossbank in Saskatchewan. The automatic bomb sight, now standard in the Hampden, simplified the bomb aimer's work by enabling him to dial information on airspeed, altitude, wind direction, and the bomb characteristics into an electromechanical computer on the run-up to the target in order to maintain the correct track of the aircraft and determine the precise moment of release. It was a substantial improvement on the course setting bomb sight that Joe trained on in Canada. It worked by combining, the course setting bomb sight worked by combining the triangle of velocitors, which the air observer had already learned to determine, with the expected trajectory of a bomb of known characteristics falling from a known height. But because the course setting bomb sight could account for wind drift, assuming that the observer could determine that, it enabled an aircraft to approach its target from any direction, not just directly along the wind line. But it was challenging to use because the bomb aimer had to preset the four key values before starting a bombing run. And the aircraft had to fly straight and level for several minutes before reaching the drop point. But even the ABS was not gyroscopically stabilized like the US Norden bomb sight, which was still unavailable to the Royal Air Force at that time. So now, on approach to the target, the Hampden's pilot and observer needed the utmost coordination between them while trying to ignore the searchlights and the anti-aircraft fire coming up from below. Joe needed Jerry to fly straight and level in order to stabilize his bomb sight, while Jerry needed Joe to direct his course on the final run-in. With the bomb bay doors now open, and at the moment Joe thought he had his target lined up, he pressed the bomb release button. As the load of 500 and 250-pound high-explosive bombs, along with two cans of Deckers, which was a form of incendiary bomb, fell away, the aircraft jerked upwards. And then Joe gave Jerry the course back to Coningsby and settled in for the return trip. They arrived back at Coningsby safely in low cloud about 2 hours before sunrise, 7 hours and 10 minutes after takeoff. 14 other 106 Squadron crews returned around the same time. Each was debriefed by intelligence officers about what they saw and did over wartime coffee improved with rum. Joe's crew reported that they had been unable to reserve the results of their bombing. And here's Joe's diary for the week, that first week of his operations. And his entry after he got home from Mannheim was, "Here we go. Had my first operation trip over Mannheim. Flew with a veteran, Sergeant Roberts. Plenty of searchlights around target. Lots of anti-aircraft after we left. The weather was poor. I didn't hit the target. Some did. About 100 kites all told were on this raid. So number one under my belt. Now I will get started." And during the next 10 days, Joe's crew was assigned to factory and railway targets in Essen, Kiel, Hanover, and Dusseldorf, but only once was his target clearly visible, and he could see where his bombs had landed. Joe was exhilarated and amazed to have completed his first operations on enemy targets, for which he had been preparing for over a year. But how much damage was he really inflicting on the enemy? Bomber Command had been forced to abandon daylight bombing before the end of 1939. During the first few months of the night bombing offensive, bomber crews learned that they could not reliably map read over a darkened landscape, nor rely on dead reckoning or radio fixes to find their way, as these became less reliable with increasing distance from base, not least on account of the difficulty of wind finding en route. Astral navigation, if sky conditions permitted, could only locate you within 5 or 10 miles. By late 1940, there were suspicions that only a third of crews were reaching their primary targets. Crews that did find the target area, however, could stooge around for up to a half an hour looking for the exact bombing point and attack it from 4,000 or 5,000 feet with a loss rate of less than 2%. Unfortunately, the 250 to 500 pound general purpose bombs did not do much damage, even if accurately placed, because they had a low explosive to casing ratio. So for the most part, the Germans could repair damage to military, industrial, and transport facilities quickly and carry on. And over the course of 1941, Germany improved its ability to defend against bomber attacks very substantially. The first line of defense consisted of radar stations along the coast on the North Sea. The second consisted of what was became known as the Camhover Line, which was 100 kilometers inland and about 20 kilometers deep. And what it was a system of night fighter bases and searchlight arrays coordinated by a second line of radar. The Camhover Line was divided into sectors or boxes, each assigned one night fighter guided by a ground controller. By midsummer 1941, there were about 100 of these. And when the searchlights were turned off, you knew you were being hunted by a night fighter, which went a good deal faster than your bomber. It was a very effective system, except in heavy cloud, and it robbed Bomber Command of the advantage of navigating by moonlight. By midsummer 1941, most losses were to night fighters rather than anti-aircraft fire. The inner line of defense consisted of searchlight and anti-aircraft batteries arrayed around the key cities and industrial areas of Ruhr here, Berlin, Hamburg, Kiel. By this time, searchlights could capture and cone a bomber and dazzle its crew up to 3 miles in the air. 88 millimeter artillery shells rose to that height in 10 seconds and exploded into a spray of shrapnel or flak, and a direct hit was not necessary to damage an aircraft. Bomber Command's loss rate was now running around 4%. So, 1940's practices were no longer safe. Crews had to bomb from greater heights, 10 to 14,000 feet, go in quickly and get away. And pilots could not expect to maintain a straight and level run on final approach. So bomb aiming became less accurate on both counts. The effect of German defenses then was to raise losses and reduce bombing accuracy. So what all this meant for the air offensive was a step-by-step move toward aerial bombing, mainly because of the near impossibility of accurate night bombing, but also of the Royal Air Force's conviction that it would crack German morale. And after relatively ineffective precision offensives against oil production and naval facilities the previous winter, the Air Council issued a new directive on the 9th of July, 1941. An all-out attack on Germany's strategic war industries and transport systems, with the objective of dealing a crippling blow to Germany's capacity to wage war. And it was for this new phase of the offensive that most of those newly operations-ready Canadian arrivals would be pressed into service. But by the summer of 1941, Bomber Command only had about 450 serviceable aircraft with crews, and on any given night could only put no more than 80% of those into service. And the total bomb weight per aircraft was about 2,000 pounds. So the Royal Air Force simply didn't have a large or effective enough force to convert what had up to then amounted to little more than nuisance raids into decisive damage. The limitations of night bombing were confirmed in August 1941 by the Butt Report, a specially commissioned analysis of photos taken by night cameras carried on bomber aircraft. And it revealed that the great majority of crews that had reported success had in fact not bombed within 5 miles of the target. In conditions of thick haze, which were very common in the Ruhr industrial area, and no moon, no more than 1 in 50 crews correctly identified the target area. And dismal as these findings were, they addressed only the location of bomb landings and not the damage they inflicted on the target. Until radio navigation aids still under development would come into service, and that was not expected for at least another 6 months, there was no immediate fix. A more immediate response was to install cameras on all bomber aircraft. When the observer released his bombs, a flare was also dropped that was timed to light up the target area before the bombs landed. The observer opened the camera shutter just after impact, so a good photo required the pilot to fly straight and level now for an additional 30 seconds or so that it took the bombs to fall from that height. And those photos could confirm the location of the aircraft and so pinpoint bomb bursts, although searchlights and decoy fires could obscure the results. Night photography documented the occurrence of navigation failures, but it couldn't fix them. Bomber Command's Commander-in-Chief, Sir Richard Pierce, put the blame squarely on his navigators, who, he asserted, needed to pull up their socks, adding that improvement would come if air observers, quote, take a personal grip on the situation and kill any tendency to complacency which may have grown up because of the known difficulties of night navigation. Where 18 months prior, the RAF had dismissed the importance of navigation and the need for trained air observers, now things were turning around, but it was far too late. In the meantime, air observers were under fire to improve their performance by honing the dead reckoning, astro-navigation, map reading, and radio fixing skills they had already learned, and making better use of the compasses, sextants, radio direction finders, and wind finding aids already available to them. Yet, it was nearly impossible to find a target by dead reckoning over a darkened landscape. Astro-navigation could confirm proximity to a target within a few miles, but only when the upper atmosphere was clear, cloud-free, a condition that would rarely prevail during the coming autumn and winter. And once close to the target, the crew had to find the aiming point, accurately direct their bombs at it, and hope they would do the damage intended. The Butt Report's findings, even if not fully disclosed to air crews, must have been as disturbing to them as it was to their commanders. Joe knew that he had not always been able to find or hit the exact aiming points he had been assigned on his first sorties, but he believed he had bombed the target cities with attendant destruction on at least 3 out of 4. Other crews were providing similar reports to intelligence officers on debriefing. And here are the kinds of things you see in the squadron reports. Large flashes followed by explosions. Bursts observed in the target area. Fire seemed to break out, were phrases commonly recorded. And another common one was results not observed. And this last one meant more than intended. Fires, flashes, and bomb bursts did not necessarily mean destruction, as daylight reconnaissance photos were beginning to reveal, but looking down at night, crews couldn't know that. By this time, the last week of September in 1941, less than 2 months into Joe's operational tour, 106 Squadron had lost 10 crews, or about a third of its complement. And the Canadian contingent of air observers in 106 Squadron had already peaked, most having already been killed or captured. As the nights lengthened in October and the weather got worse, Bomber Command crews pressed on, but with few illusions of their success. So Joe's flying log for the month of October 1941, the last that he did was on 7 Ops that month. And that same month, he began setting out his observations on the problems of night bombing and what, in his opinion, were needed to set things straight. Noteworthy in this particular air extract is his awareness of the morale justification for area bombing and the failure to concentrate on key targets. Now, Joe can't have been alone in these views. These matters would have been regular topics of discussion among flying crews based on their ongoing experiences. 3 months into Bomber Command's all-out strategic offensive against Germany, its flyers were well aware of its limitations and of the reasons for them. They knew they were engaged in area bombing, and they knew it was directed more against Germany's morale than its actual military and industrial capacities. And they knew that precision bombing could not and would not be achieved by more attentive dead reckoning and astro-navigation, more meticulous paperwork, and more intensive intelligence debriefings. In the meantime, until the heavy bombers with radio navigation aids came into general service, Bomber Command and its crews had to carry on as best they could. In November, Churchill ordered Bomber Command to reduce its efforts until it could regroup. And over that winter, the command experimented in target marking and bombing tactics. At the end of November, Joe's pilot had completed his tour of operations, but the rest of the crew still had several more sorties to go. This was the consequence of the chaotic crewing arrangements that I mentioned in the Hampden up to the spring of 1941. So they were given a brand new pilot with officer rank while they remained non-commissioned officers. However, Joe, newly promoted now to flight sergeant, was designated the captain of his aircraft. Joe's letters became more somber as the winter set in. He knew his chances of going home were slim, but he hoped that he could at least get through the next few weeks until new aircraft and navigation aids came into service. Here's an example of a censored letter. He wrote home about the loss of his closest pal and roommate from Canada, and about his concerns about the squadron's imminent conversion to the underpowered and failure-prone twin-engine Manchester, which was the predecessor of the Lancaster. On the 28th of January, Bomber Command launched an assault on Munster in atrocious weather conditions. 4 aircraft were lost from 106 Squadron alone, its worst night of the war to date, and one of those was Joey Jacobson's. Of the 84 aircraft detailed to Munster that night, fewer than half reached the target and none saw it. Icing was extremely hazardous to the main force bombers, including the Hampden, which could not surmount severe icing conditions and so had to fly through them. And Joe's new pilot had no flying experience in icing conditions. Between the resulting drain on fuel and the prospects of severe headwinds on return, Joe may have decided that they had insufficient fuel to make it back across the North Sea. It would appear that the crew attempted to land on an open field near the German frontier. Barely under control, the aircraft clipped the trees on the edge of the field, stalled, crash-landed on its belly, and separated into 3 or 4 parts. It's a bit hard to see, but this photo was actually taken by a young woman, a young lad from the village who went out the next morning on his bike. You can see, well, there's the port wing. The aircraft by this time, it's hard to see, but it's actually separated. It looks like it's all in one piece on the ground, but it isn't. The standard procedure for a forced landing was for the air observer to crouch behind the pilot's seat and the wireless operator air gunners to brace against the main spar facing backwards, which is how the four men were found the next morning. None survived. This is a shot of the aircraft being dismantled by Belgian forced laborers a few days after the event. The news was received at home on the 30th of January. 40,000 Canadian families received telegrams like this during the war, 10,000 from Bomber Command alone. The funeral I mentioned at the beginning of my talk was held on the 1st of February. And here's a photo of the ceremony at the cemetery. And I would like now to show you. This is the film of the funeral. This is a shot of the aircraft through the woods. There were two gentlemen in the village that had movie cameras during the war. Here the bodies are being recovered from the aircraft. There were only three coffins for the four because there was a shortage of wood. The other was brought in a shroud. This is at the hospital of Lichtenvoorde. The body's being unloaded off a horse-drawn carriage that came to the site. When I first went to Lichtenvoorde about 15 years ago, that hospital was still there. This was filmed from a window, a small window in a building opposite. This is under the occupation, of course. You can imagine the German authorities were not too keen on such things happening. When the bodies were brought into the hospital, the Germans said, "We want their flying suits." And the nurse said, "No, no, you're not having those. They get buried the way they flew." And here, the funeral carriages are being assembled. They hired four horse-drawn hearses for the occasion. And here you can see the procession from the hospital down to the general cemetery. It's being led by a couple of local officials, and then you see the funeral carriages. The funeral cost 538 guilders, and the town authority sent a bill to the Germans, which the Germans paid. Here's the platoon of German occupational force. And look at the number of people streaming down here. There are hundreds following this. But this is during the occupation. And here's the site of the cemetery. That's a bit hard to see. I'll stop it there. In 1950, Joe's parents, Percy and May, visited Lichtenvoorde while on a trip to Europe. And there they met Hendrik Leemreize, who had cared for the graves of the four airmen, and they were shown the film that had been made of the funeral 8 years before. Leemreize, in the years after, had been instrumental in assisting downed airmen to escape and return to England. and after the war he received the King's Medal for Courage in the cause of freedom, one of about 200 persons on whom Britain bestowed this honor. And this is Joe's grave today, Commonwealth, standard Commonwealth War grave. There's 23 in that particular, but there were several other crews who came down later in the war, but they were the first. Well, let me say a few words about the Hampden. The Hadley Page Hampden came into service in 1938. There were 1,430 of them made, mostly in England, but there were 160 that were built in Canada. And here's one being carried along the streets in Montreal. You can see that it was done on a kind of, if you like, an IKEA flat pack mode that could be disassembled. And 84 of them were sent to Britain. Here's some leaving Halifax. The rest of the Canadian-made ones were, for the most part, I believe, sent to Patricia Bay, British Columbia, for RAF's 32 operational training unit. Hampdens were taken out of the air offensive against Germany in early 1942. 106 Squadron retired its last Hampden about 8 weeks after Joey Jacobson was killed, and he was the last of the Canadian air observers in that batch to be killed. Five Group converted first to Manchester's and then by the spring to Lancaster's. Hampdens continued in limited service on anti-shipping operations in Europe and for training as at Patricia Bay. There are no airworthy Hampdens still in existence, but there are at least three in various stages of restoration and reconstruction. The most complete is at the Canadian Museum of Flight in Langley, British Columbia. And here we have a starboard view, similar to the view that I showed you earlier on of the four guys standing in front of the aircraft. Again, the air observer's compartment, pilot's position. And there's the bomb aimer's position. That's my cousin standing in, he's standing actually in the hatchway that one would have had to bail out of. That wing was recovered from the sea near Patricia Bay and was restored in appearance, but not in its interior. It lost a wing during a heavy snowfall, but it's since been reattached. Another Hampden is being reconstructed from various salvaged wrecks at the Royal Air Force Museum in Cosford in England. And I was lucky enough to get in there during the 1 week each year when the conservation area is open to the public. And here is a nice view of the starboard side fuselage and wing roof. Again, a nice view of the nice view of the lower air gunner's position here, and there's the upper. There are some of the plans that they're using to help reconstruct that aircraft. And yet another is being reconstructed from scratch, based on the original plans, at the Lincolnshire Aviation Heritage Center. And this gentleman here, who is doing the reconstruction, I've met him on several occasions over the years. You can see this is the upper part, the front and upper part of the fuselage. Again, this would be the beginning of the air observer's compartment. There's the pilot's cockpit, and he's demonstrating here a kind of a replica. Well, there's a replica of the machine guns that the gunners would have used. And in this one, this is a view looking ahead to the cockpit area, looking from the rear. And this last one is the bottom part of the fuselage. This is an upside down, imagine it going this way. And here would be the ramp underneath the pilot's seat, which the air observer had to descend underneath to get to his compartment. With any luck, I may get to the American Aviation Heritage Center in a month or so, and I can bring you up to date on how it's progressing. The fellow that's working on it, it's a cold, unheated section of the museum, and he doesn't work there in the winter. So it's going slowly, but hopefully it'll move along. For those of you who want to know more about the Hampden, the Bible is Harry Moyle's now rare book called The Hampden File. Good luck on finding it. Anyway, thank you very much.
He was Jewish at the time?
No, it's interesting that there was no, for reasons I have been unable to establish, it seems that none of those four, or at least for sure three out of the four, were not wearing their identification tags. Joe's the only one who was Jewish on that flight, but for whatever reason, they didn't. And so they were not at first identified. When the family got the, you know, in this case, of course, an aircraft goes missing, just reported missing, and they went to the Red Cross to report on, and eventually, you know, the Germans communicated that this particular aircraft had gone down, and then, of course, the British know who's on it, but that's... And in fact, the bodies have never been identified. There was a thing, after the war, there was a unit called the Missing Research and Inquiry Service, which tried to find downed aircraft and eventually, you know, and identify, often they exhumed graves and so on. The records of this of the unit that operated in Holland are missing, but it's my understanding that although the bodies were exhumed, they were never identified, and consequently, the policy of the War Graves Commission was the graves are labeled in alphabetical order. So, but no, it was not known that he was Jewish at the time. They had no way of knowing that. So when the pastor said these unknown airmen, they really didn't know who those guys were.
Peter, do you know if the movie was filmed surreptitiously or was it openly filmed?
Oh, it was absolutely surreptitious. Oh, yeah. No. They got, if this had happened any later in the war, I think it just wouldn't have happened at all. There was it's a rural part of Holland. There was a very light occupational force. There had been no sort of really active resistance in the area at the time. This event actually kind of galvanized the local resistance. After that funeral, there was a network of which that gentleman, Lemrise, was one, who assisted downed pilots and provided the network to feed them. At that point, they got them back into Spain and then back into England. It was certainly surreptitious. And there was another photographer who hid in the tree. There's the cemetery at Lichtenvoorde is surrounded by high trees, and people were up in the trees witnessing the funeral, and this one photographer was among them. So no, they concealed themselves, and it was a point of great pride for them to be able to show the families. And I know Joey's pilots, I've been in communication with his daughter. She remembers as a child going to see the film also.